C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL, News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, I think it's fair to say Maryland's going to be in the national news
in the
next couple of months because the race for U.S. Senate is going to be fierce, and it is going to be one that draws the attention of, I think, both presidential candidates and obviously Democrats and Republicans across the country. We are pleased to be joined now by one of those candidates, the former governor of Maryland and who wants to be the next U.S. Senator, Larry Hogan. Great to have
morning,
you
governor.
On, Governor.
Hey, good morning, Brian. Good morning, C4. How are you guys?
We're doing great. I will start because, you know, some people have called you the old governor instead of the former governor, and you've taken that to a new
one. I kind of like it.
Yeah. Okay.
Governor Moore, you know, he keeps calling me the old governor recently, and I thought it was pretty funny. So we put out a new merch line, OG, the OG governor. I'm going to get you guys some T-shirts. They're just coming out. They're hot off the press.
I love it.
That's what. Why do you think I saw that from a couple of other people online as well. Any idea of why they've decided to say old governor instead of former governor, which is normally what?
I think they said their main plan was for, you know, Wes Moore to kind of change what he'd been saying. You know, he'd been saying nice things for a long time. But the plan is they're going to have him attack me and attack my record and, you know, call me names and. You know, I don't think it's going to work, but, you know, I'm glad to play along.
There are a lot of issues, Governor Larry Hogan, we're going to talk with you about. You're unveiling a new 10-point crime plan this morning. We're going to get to that before we let you go. But I have to start with what's the prevailing issue right now, and that is what's happening in Israel right now. You came out on social media. You've also talked about it. The International Criminal Court's decision to issue an arrest warrant against Israel at the same time that they're doing it against Hamas. This is going to be a huge issue for whoever the next United States Senator is, Governor.
Well, I've been a strong advocate and champion for Israel, and you know what happened on October 7th was a horrific attack by terrorists, by Hamas, and this ICC issuing arrest warrants for the Israeli leaders is just disgraceful, and we should absolutely deal with that. You know, just last night I had the honor of sitting down with the mom of Hirsch Goldberg Poland, who was one of the hostages that's still being held after 229 days, and whose arm was blown off and was recently in a video. And I'm telling you, and there are 45 U.S. This is American citizens. And when else did we ever leave American citizens behind like that and not, you know, support, you know, obtaining their release? It's just something that we've got to deal with. But all the folks that are calling for, I understand the concern about the loss of innocent lives on either side. But what we have to do is return those hostages, bring them all home, and we've got to get the terrorists responsible for October 7th to turn themselves in, so we can bring it to a halt.
Well, how would you describe the way President Biden has handled the situation in Israel, which has kind of changed and morphed and flip-flopped a couple of different times?
Yeah, I think it's kind of typical of his entire foreign policy. It's, waffling from crisis to crisis and continually changing the plan, showing weakness to the world. Ever since the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan, we've had nothing but, you know, people, our allies no longer trust us and our enemies no longer fear us. It's why Putin felt perfectly comfortable rolling into Ukraine. And we've been, you know, slow to, you know, to support them and stop Putin before he rolls into a NATO country. It's why we're waffling on our support of Israel. It's why we haven't provided help to Taiwan as China's threatening. So, you know, I'm a Reagan peace through strength guy. And if we want to, stop some of these things from happening, you can't just be, kowtowing to the bad guys and the terrorists and showing weakness to the world.
We're speaking of the former governor of the state of Maryland and now Republican nominee for United States Senate from Maryland. Larry Hogan is on board with us. And, of course, another huge issue in front of you, Governor Hogan, if you will be elected to the United States Senate, and that is the rebuilding of the Francis Scott Key Bridge and kind of the whole issue of how that's going to be done. Apparently, you had a meeting with United States Senator Tom Carper recently in reference to how we get the funding for this done. Can you talk about what your vision would be as a senator in terms of the funding to make sure we get either 100% funding or close to that?
Well, I right away, look, when the first day of this, I reached out to Governor Moore and I said that we're all Team Maryland. I'm going to do whatever it takes. This should not be a Republican or Democratic issue. And I reached out to a number of leaders in the Senate and pushed for, you know, how this is not just important to Baltimore or the state of Maryland. This is a major issue with respect to the supply chain and 2/3 of the states in the country, and that we have to get it done. And I also pushed the Biden administration to streamline federal regulations so that we can get it done faster. You know, the federal regulations will slow it down by several years, and we got to get this thing built more quickly. But it was a big week this week in that as we move the dolly out of the way and we're starting to get closer to opening the channel fully, I mean, it's great progress, and I was incredibly honored on the same day to have the guys at the port, the International Longshoremen's Association, the union, came out and endorsed me because of our incredible support for the port and growing all those jobs for the past 8 years.
Governor, we know that abortion is going to be a big deal in this election, and it has been a pretty significant issue in the last couple of years since the overturn of Roe. You've recently said that you would support legislation that would make Roe the law of the land in every state. So does that mean, the way I understand that or how I read that, is that you would be in favor of a national law that would say abortion is legal? Could you just elaborate on what you mean by making Roe the law of the land?
Well, you know, it was the law for 50 years, and that's the way we were operating. And I mean, there's a compromise bill that Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski and Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema have that would just re-enshrine the pre-existing law. And now the Democrats want to take it much further, but I don't. But look, this is it's an issue in that that's all the Democrats will talk about, because they think that this is, you know, the only thing people are going to make their decisions on. But this goes back to 2014 when I first ran. Anthony Brown ran $10 million worth of commercials attacking me on this issue. And I responded and said I was going to protect women's rights. I was going to do anything to change Maryland law. And I lived up to that commitment for 8 years. In 2018, Ben Jealous attacked me on abortion. And we said, hey, promise made, promise kept. I didn't do anything to take away access to abortion for any women in Maryland. And now it's all over again. When I announced 90 days ago or whatever it was, both Trone and Alsobrooks attacked me, saying I would be the deciding vote for a national abortion ban, which is completely false. I said I wouldn't support it at all. We're going to have to continue to remind and respond to people, but I don't think this is what the election is going to be decided about. And my record is very clear. I think the people of Maryland know where I am, and we have a record. And hopefully, you know, they won't listen to the sort of false rhetoric, the lies, and the kind of, you know, smear campaign from these other guys trying to rewrite history and change my position.
Okay, but does that mean you're in favor, you would be in favor of an abortion all the way up to, you know, in the third
trimester? No, that's not what Roe does. It has a limitation on 26 weeks, and the Democrats, including Andrew Alsobrooks, want to go further than that and take it up to the moment of birth.
Okay, so you would say 26 weeks where it was before. There's been.
I'm not going to get into the details of it. What the Roe law was for, you know, for 50 years. We're just going to put it back in place, and that's what it was.
So you would not be in favor, because Lindsey Graham, Republican, has said 15 weeks. You know, that number has been floated around. Yours is 26?
Yeah, I've been through it over and over again. I'm supporting the bill that has 26 weeks that's restores Roe. Okay.
Governor Larry Hogan is on board with us. And when it comes to the issue of crime, you have just unveiled today, as a matter of fact, we're breaking it now, a 10-point crime plan in place. And I want to talk about one that we've talked about before when you were governor, and this was one of the big sticking points in terms of how to drive crime down, and that is holding prosecutors and judges more accountable for this process when it comes to repeat violent offenders. That is your fifth point on here, hold prosecutors and Senate-confirmed nominees accountable. Can you talk about that, Governor?
Well, sure. I mean, C4, you know, we've been trying to, first of all, hold the criminals accountable. And that's point number one, is to take the repeat violent criminals off the streets and hold them accountable. But we put in legislation before, while I was governor, to hold a judicial transparency bill to hold them accountable, because it was outrageous that people were being arrested, you know, 5-6 times for violent crimes and doing no time and being let out in the streets. And, you know, we have some prosecutors, you know, including in Baltimore City previously, that refused to prosecute crimes. Certainly, we have some great. Most of the prosecutors in Maryland are great, you can see a marked difference in what's happening in Baltimore City with Ivan Bates from his predecessor. You know, we started to turn crime down in Baltimore City in 2002, and it's continuing to, you know, trend in a good direction through 2023. So a lot has to do with it's the police trying to do their jobs, but it's the court system. If the prosecutors aren't prosecuting and the judges aren't sentencing, then it's just a revolving door catching and release. And so that's certainly an important issue. You know, we a lot of this stuff we fought with the legislature to try to get some things done. We passed some of them. Some of them they continue to not support. This issue with the juvenile crime bill, which was horrible and devastating to the community. I vetoed it. They overrode the veto. And that was the main topic of discussion in this session. They tweaked it and, you know, nibbled around the edges. But as Ivan Bates said, it's not going to make a heck of a difference. And they have to come back and do far more. And, you know, the easy thing would just be to repeal that bill and take it back to where it was when I vetoed it.
When it comes to Social Security and Medicare, obviously it's been talked a lot about. Former President Trump has basically said he doesn't want to touch it. Other Republicans say you have to. Where are you right now regarding those two big issues of Social Security and Medicare?
Well, I don't think any of that's going to get solved in the middle of an election year, you know, with all the rhetoric on both sides. But certainly we've got to figure out. This is one of those things where Republicans and Democrats are, you know, pointing fingers and trying to game the system and blame each other while, you know, nothing's getting fixed. And I think we've got to figure out a way to protect Social Security and Medicare and find some common sense, long-term solutions to make sure that it's solvent so that we have the money to pay people the benefits that they earn.
Last week, Governor Hogan, Democrats for Hogan was launched. You made the announcement, but also you were joined by former Democratic State Senator Bobby Zirk. Now, he's still a Democrat. I don't mean former Democrat, but he's former senator.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, he is did a video on this. Now, that's, of course, recognizing that Maryland is overwhelmingly Democrat. You need Democratic votes. But are you concerned that some Democrats might be hesitant about voting for you because if they do, Republicans could get the Senate under a Trump presidency, that might be problematic? How do you answer that to Democrats that are concerned?
Sure. Well, yeah, we are very appreciative and proud to have Senator Zirkin stepping up and helping to lead this effort for us. We're going to be rolling out, you know, more Democratic leaders in the coming weeks. But this is, you know, this is something much bigger than just a list of endorsements. Our campaign is going to be about make sure that Democrats know that there's home for them in our campaign. I've always been a big believer in a big tent. I got elected in 14 with a Democrats for Hogan effort and reelected in 18 with the Democrats for Hogan effort. I was only 23% of the people in Maryland are Republicans. So obviously I was able to win over a large portion of independents and Democrats. And but I think I get the concern about, well, you're going to go down there. You're just going to be a typical Republican and you're going to support the MAGA agenda. I don't think there's anyone in Maryland that believes I'm going to be a supporter of the MAGA agenda since I was one of the leading outspoken critics of it for, you know, the past 8 years. But I am going to be a person that's going to go down there and try to fix the broken politics and represent everybody in the state. And I think people know that from the past 8 years, that's exactly the kind of person I'll be. And that I'm not going there to push one party. You know, I've always been a bipartisan guy that reaches across the aisle to get things done. That's desperately needed in Congress right now because the whole system is broken. And I'm probably the only one that's willing to and has proven that he's willing to stand up to the current president, the former president, to the Democratic Party or the Republican Party. And I think, you know, that's exactly what they're looking for in Washington, not another rubber stamp, you know, freshman Democrat in the minority.
You're MAGA rhino, right? I mean, I hate to use those terms, but I mean, that's kind of.
Well, look, during the primary, there were millions and millions of dollars being run. And people don't realize, I had an opponent that outspent me like 3 or 4 to 1. It was running attack ads saying I was a rhino that wouldn't support Trump while David Trone and Angela Alsobrooks were saying I was the deciding vote for the MAGA agenda. They were showing like January 6th, like it was my fault. And, you know, it's if both sides are, you know, screaming and hollering and spending millions of dollars attacking you, then maybe you're in the right spot.
Yeah. On debates, would you be open to debates with Angela Alsobrooks? You know, how many would you like to have? And what where are you on debates?
I mean, we'd love to do it. We're waiting to figure out what the strategy might be. But look, I love the debate. I'm sure she would like to do it as well. And in the last, you know, couple of Senate races, I think they only did one, and the governor's race won. But I'd like to see, maybe we may try to get two debates, one in one region and one in the other. But yeah, I look forward to that.
Finally, from me, former Maryland Governor Larry Hogan, now Republican nominee for United States Senate. What is your message, though, to Maryland? Why should Marylanders consider Larry Hogan come November?
Well, I think most people in Maryland and most people in America are, I think their number one issue is they're completely fed up and disgusted with the current divisive, angry politics. And they're sick and tired of absolutely nothing getting done in Washington, divisiveness and dysfunction. They're sick of the kind of loudest, angriest voices on the extremes of both parties getting all the attention. And they want it to be fixed. You know, they want to get back to some kind of a normalcy, and they want to find a way for us to find common ground for the common good. And I'm exactly the person to go do that. It's what's completely lacking in Washington. And, you know, I think they know that after 8 years of representing them as governor, that I'm going to be the exact same guy in the Senate, that I don't mind standing up to anyone or either side and doing what I think is right for the people of Maryland.
Last for me, and that is, you know, you got a little over 60% of the Republican primary. You're going to need those other Republicans who went in a different route to vote for you in November. Yeah. How confident are you, and what is your message to those Republican voters?
Well, it was my largest victory in any primary or general election in history by more than 20 points. We had about 65% of the vote in a six-way race. We were thrilled with that. But obviously, we want to get the support of all, you know, in order to win in Maryland, we have to get most of the Republicans, most of the independents, and about 30% of the Democrats. And that's what I've been able to do twice. It's why I was only the second Republican governor reelected in the 248-year history of the state. And we've got to do it again. I understand that some folks in the base of the party might have an issue or two that they're not thrilled with, but I don't think they're going to be that excited about voting for a far-left Democrat.
Well, OG Hogan, we're looking for our T-shirts somewhere down the road.
You guys got OG shirts on the way.
Very, very good.
And in the meantime, good luck on the campaign trail, and hopefully in your travels between now and November, we can get you here in studio one day, okay?
I would love to. I'll bring the shirts.
There you go.
Thank you, Larry Hogan. Appreciate your time.
All right. Thank you, guys.
I appreciate it. Former Maryland Governor Larry Hogan.